So with that, I'd like to turn it over next to Sergey Paltsev. Sergey is the Deputy Director of the MIT Joint Program on the Science and Policy of Global Change. He's Senior Research Scientist at the MIT Energy Initiative. And he is, I think, very importantly for this, he's the Director of the new Energy at Scale Low Carbon Energy Center. So Sergey, I welcome you, and I'll turn over the mic to you.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for this great introduction. I'm very pleased to open and set the stage for the wonderful panel discussion. But before I do that, let me try to share my screen. So hopefully now the screen is visible. As Bob Armstrong and CJ Gu has mentioned, we are very excited to be involved in this interaction with the industry, but also the government entities and NGOs, because indeed we believe that that's who is going to make the difference. So that's why we are truly believe that we need to work with companies from all the sectors of the economy, from all regions of the world, because if they decide that it's economic, it's in their interest to speed up, to scale up the energy transformation, that's what is going to push it to the levels which are needed. And I'm also very excited to set up the stage for the panel, because all the representatives who are in the panel involved with MIT in many different projects, and in terms of their involvement with the Energy at Scale Center, they actually cover a lot of different activities and a lot of different research which we do. So all the way from carbon capture and storage to electrification to the impacts of the climate change on the physical infrastructure to looking at the scenarios for energy development and energy mix in different regions of the world. So the task for the next 25 minutes of my presentation is going to be as follows. So most likely I'll spend 90% of my allocated time on the first 5-6 slides, just to make sure that we are on the same page and we are covering all the important things which the panel can expand upon. And then I'll obviously not going to be able to cover all of the activities and all of the issues which are related to energy at scale. But I'll provide you some additional slides, and hopefully I'll create enough interest that then I'm at the end of the slide deck. Then you will see our contact information. You will have a great ideas about how to engage with us in terms of using our expertise and our tools to help you to solve your questions. So be prepared for that last slide with the contact information. Feel free to send the email requesting additional information about any of the research or any of the papers which I'm going to mention. And again, we are hoping to expand our interaction with the industries and different companies from all of the spectrum of the economy. So I'll start with the statement, just to make sure that we're all at the same page, is that the world has to decarbonize. And there is no question about that. And at this point, there is not much discussion. And even those who are not really believe that that's the way where we are going currently, the society and the policy and the actions are going to bring you into that way. So it means that if you're in this domain, you already most likely are thinking very hard how to get into this new reality and how to make sure that your current practices and current technologies are not going to be obsolete in a very not very distant future. So we need to make sure that we are decarbonizing. So that's not the question. The question is how fast and how to get there. And so on this slide, you see some of the emission trajectory from the IPCC 1.5 degree report. One thing which I would like to take your attention into about the trajectories for emission reduction. Those are extremely aggressive emission reductions, which are needed in order to fulfill those goals which are stated in the Paris Agreement. So well below 1.5. Look at those reductions by the middle of a century. And you see that the action has to be accelerated if indeed those goals are staying within the reach. And energy is playing the major role in this decarbonization agenda. So you can see that, a substantial amount is coming out of the energy. So these two pie charts or pizza charts, if you're in Italy or if you're in Massachusetts, then what I'm showing here is the breakout of the different components of the greenhouse gas emissions, global greenhouse gas emissions in two shapes. So the diagram on your left shows you how the greenhouse gas emissions are divided by economic sector, the global greenhouse gas emissions. And one message is already apparent that even if we are going to decarbonize electricity and heat production, if we are going to decarbonize transportation fully, not just light duty vehicles, but the whole transportation, if we are going to decarbonize part of the industry, still there are a lot of emissions which are still going to be remaining there. Similarly, a lot of impact is going to come from carbon dioxide from fossil fuel industrial processes, but it's not only game in town. So we need to pay attention to methane, we need to pay attention to other gases, and we need to pay attention to carbon dioxide from forestry and agricultural use and other land use related activities. Why it's important? Because more and more governments, companies and different jurisdictions are announcing the pledges for net zero by a certain time. So usually, again, informed by that report, which I showed at the beginning, IPCC 1.5, usually the statements are for 2050. And you have heard from different jurisdictions. So for example, European Union has net zero climate neutral agenda by 2050 in terms of all greenhouse gases. California has one, Massachusetts, individual companies. So there are a lot of recent announcements from the energy companies. So like BP, Shell, Dow, Total, a lot of them are announcing net zero targets. Well, some of them with the fine print, just to make sure that you are reading that fine print, what exactly that means. But the point is, all those emissions has to go to zero. And as you can see, that's a quite challenging task ahead of us. Well, at the same time, that creates not only challenges, that creates opportunities for that scalable low carbon option, because we need the solutions which are not going to work in just some tiny fraction of the economy. We need the solutions to decarbonize the whole economy. So in terms of the questions, there are a lot of variations, and unfortunately, it's not the one simple question which we need to address. So often the question is, well, do we have a technology to decarbonize? But there are a lot of other challenges in addition to available technologies which we still need to resolve in order to fulfill this task. So in terms of the economics, in addition to the technology, we need to make sure that those technologies are making economic sense, that we have the policies which are supporting them to make them economically competitive. Also, a lot of things would require lifestyle changes. And so we will talk about that. I'll expand about that a little bit later. But that's a very different world which we may see ahead of us in comparison to what we are seeing today. And in fact, well, currently, with the global pandemic, we already see that the world is changing. Also, there are substantial geopolitical impacts of the decarbonization. because decarbonization is not the only goal for the society. Other goals are no less important, like removing the poverty, reducing the income inequality, while the public health issues. So there are many other things where decarbonization agenda is going to interact with other agendas which governments will have in mind. Also, well, we already see that the closing borders after pandemic brought a lot of concerns, a lot of concerns about the rise of the protectionism, a lot of concerns that the supply chains might be broken and you need to bring your activities to your jurisdiction. So for example, while we see a lot of gadgets, well, designed in California, made in China. Well, if we are going to see the world where we will see gadgets which are designed in California and made in California, that is going to have a lot of implications for energy use in that particular sector, for decarbonization options, for competitiveness of those industries. So a lot of aspects which are going to be dependent on these type of the decisions. And we also saw even the stability of current traditional energy exporters also might be in questions, and that's also extremely important how to resolve those issues. It's not just about the economics, it's not just about the geopolitics. Environmental risks, unfortunately, are going to stay with us regardless of our emission reduction efforts, because we have a lot of the inertia in our climate system, and our climate modeling is showing that regardless of the emission trajectory, in the next 10 years, maybe even next 20 years, we will be on a trajectory where we are going to see more and more impacts. So remember those fires in Australia, remember those fires in California, the droughts, extreme heats in Siberia. We are going to see more and more of that regardless of our emission trajectory. So we need to be prepared for that. And then the impacts from low carbon options. Well, I heard the story when people were talking about the internal combustion engines. They had this impression, well, in comparison to horse manure, well, that's a big environmental improvement, because, well, all we have the CO2, which, well, all humans inhale, exhale, and we are going to have water. So the question is scale. When we are scaling that technology, we might have the consequences which we don't see right now. So we need to make sure that when we are scaling the low carbon technologies, we do not have those other impacts which were not intended. And then the air pollution impacts. So the lockdown evidence show us that indeed, if we shut down the economy, we have a lot of improvement in environment, but we also saw some surprises. So what I meant by that, if you're going to take a look at the concentration of PM2.5 in Paris or Delhi during the lockdown, it actually increased rather than decreased. So that brings a lot of questions that we need the system-wide solution. So even if we are not driving, that's not cleaning up all of the sources, and we need the solutions which are going to be economy-wide and cover all the sectors. So here I'm showing the main projections, the pre-COVID projections, and obviously all of the energy forecasting agencies are going to change their projections. But this is what the main idea about the decarbonization channel, which we saw from this major scenarios team. So here I put the numbers from Shell, from BP, from MIT, from IEA. Again, these are the scenarios of decarbonization, but you can see that in terms of the global primary energy, well, we are not really in two decades decarbonizing fully. So again, if we want to be in those trajectories where we are at net zero by 2050, even this aggressive push is not enough. And I'm providing some additional information where you can compare to where the world is actually currently going. So this is the optimistic picture about the global energy mix. The way where we are currently going is not as optimistic as these trajectories. So a lot of challenges ahead of us, and we need to understand how to speed up, how to scale up this low carbon transformation. Another question is, which I usually ask, well, do we have the technologies to decarbonize? And in a lot of cases, you can hear that, well, we already have the technology, so we don't really need any new technologies. And this graph from the recently released special report from International Energy Agency, from their energy technology projections. So we are seeing that, at least in their view, to fully decarbonize, and to give you the perspective, those negative 35 gigatons of CO2, that's a full decarbonization by 2070. What their estimates are that in order to do that, in order to fulfill that, in terms of the cumulative emission reduction, one third of the emission reduction are envisioned by the technologies which are not commercially available yet. So they are still at prototype or demonstration stage today. And even those early adoption technologies, so they count like coal with CCS and as early adoption technology, and others which are already have some facilities which are still need to scale up quite dramatically. So indeed, if you are want to envision that we are going to speed up those transition, and again, I refer you to the IEA energy technology perspectives. They also have a scenario where they decarbonizing by 2050, and they provide what would be needed in order to fulfill those targets. So what, how many, for example, hydrogen-based steel plants need to be employed every month? How many biomass with CCS plants need to be employed? So quite aggressive and quite challenging task if you really want to decarbonize in such short period of time. And also a call for speed up in research and development to bring those technologies to the fore. Well, currently, a lot of attention from policymakers and the companies are actually for shorter term goals. And here I'm showing you the graph where the estimate has been done, which type of the investment is going to create more jobs. And you can see that buildings are overtaking all other parts. And so buildings, and it's a lot of construction workers and it's a lot of contractor workers. So if you really want to put your investment in order to, to go to job creation, that's the way. But if we are going to take a look at the what private stimulus money, where that is going to go, well, we need to be careful that, well, we shouldn't rely too much on the private decision where that is going to go in order to not to lock into the old technologies. So for example, I believe yesterday it was announcement by Warren Buffett, very prominent investor, of buying Dominion Energy. So that's actually in the category of unabated gas-fired power. So he is making his stimulus money of about $10 billion of betting on the technology, well, which might lock us into the system, which is still going to provide a lot of emissions down the line. And we need to make sure that we are providing a good economic case to make those investments in the technologies which are not going to lock down. I'm providing this picture just to illustrate that whatever we thought is unthinkable even short time ago, well, now we indeed in the new reality. And I'm not putting too many hidden messages into this picture. So you can go to YouTube and take a look at the video. Well, that's a very nice piece, which is played by the Spanish opera quartet. So it's a Barcelona opera house where they had a concert for a lot of potted plants rather than the audience. So why am I bringing this picture is just to say that, well, whenever we are going to take a look where we are going to end up after COVID, we really have to think about the structural changes. And that's exactly what we are currently do, how we work, how we travel, how we govern. All these are extremely important, and that is going to determine the future trajectories in terms of decarbonization. Another extremely important thing, how do you square the cheaper technology, which is available just for subset of the industries or subset of activities, which in comparison to a much more expensive technology, which would be available as a solution to a bigger pie. And immediately, while you may think of CCS, you may think of hydrogen, you may think of other applications versus those applications which will resolve the solution just in some subset. Negative emissions and hard to abate, as you can imagine, it's going to be a lot of arguing what sectors are going to be allowed to have positive emissions. And you remember those diagrams at the beginning. Well, there are many sectors which will argue, well, it's very hard to abate, and we probably will have much more expensive options in comparison to other sectors. And so the solution might be negative emissions, a lot of things which we are trying to discuss and we are trying to get an understanding of that. Well, geopolitics is not making things any easier because now we are prioritizing resilience over efficiency. So if we are moving away from globalization, well, what that means, usually that means slower economic growth, that means less money available for transition. Well, and in general, transition is easier to make when you have the growing energy needs. So then you can add new technologies in this new fashion, in the low carbon fashion. Well, it's much harder when you have decreasing energy use, because then you will need to retire earlier much bigger fleet of your current options. And so all that is not making things any easier. So as Bob has mentioned, well, that's exactly what we do at our Energy at Scale Center. And so again, at the end, I will provide you the contact information. And obviously, I'm not going to be able to cover all of the aspects, but I'll try to get into at least some indication to make sure that I will be able to provide you the feeling for our expertise and tools where we can help you with solving your issues. So we have the global integrated system model, which tracks not only human dimensions, but interactions with the Earth system and interactions with the physical impacts, not just the transitional impacts, but physical impacts. We have our economic model, which covers the whole globe and all sectors of the economy. And we are employing that widely to the cost of different options. And these options are wide, and why we need to make sure that we are covering not only the pricing, which is the main kind of beloved instrument of the IPCC or integrated assessment modeling, is because the pathway for a particular sector or particular technology might be quite different when you're considering portfolio. So if you look at, for example, just wind or just solar or just electrification of cars, you might be missing the answer in comparison to the portfolio of the technologies, because you are going to compete these technologies against each other and the answer might be quite different. So as I have mentioned, it's not only about the transitional and energy risk, it's also about the physical risks. And so this is where we are trying to understand what are the implications. And as I have mentioned, we are going to see more and more of these extreme changes and changes in average. And so this is the example of a study which we're currently doing. And also we are looking at Arctic. And so a lot of recent disasters in Arctic also are going to intensify because of the permafrost and other issues. So here the slide is providing you all different studies and different publications which we already have done on this topic, and also provide you some indication where we are currently thinking. And all of that obviously is currently covered by our thinking about how we are going to get after the COVID, how the world is going to be different. Again, I'm going to provide you the contact information. If you want more information about these studies or these papers, please contact us. We will be more than happy to follow up and provide you additional information on this breadth of topics. Just to get to somewhat summarizing all these thoughts which I provided for the industrial panel, just to reiterate that this is a global problem. So we need to find technologies and policies which are going to reduce emissions, not in one jurisdiction, but that can be applicable to the whole globe. Because if Europe decarbonizes and nobody follows, we are still not going to solve the issue. So we need to find the solutions which are going to be applicable in India, in China, in Africa, in Latin America, in all places of the world. Unfortunately, we cannot find a single or simple bullet. So it means that we need to search a lot for different answers. And this is where public acceptance and policy support are extremely important. Another consideration is even timing. So what if we are not going to decarbonize by 2050? Then what? What if we are going to decarbonize by 2070? Well, we also can expand on that, and we have the capability to show what are the implications of that. And the obvious conclusion, which you would expect to see from the academic institution, that we need more research. But that's not just a mantra. We really need more research on scaling up in order to understand what are the best way to do that. So I also want to make sure that while I'm including all the researchers which are currently involved in the center, and as Bob mentioned, we are involving many other centers. And so just to make sure that I'm acknowledging the important contributions from our researchers. And this is the slide which I'm hoping you are going to take home, or at least pay attention to this email. And if you are interested in following up with us on any of the aspects or expand these topics which I just covered, please contact Horacio Capiran, and he will be more than happy to arrange the further discussions. So that's the end of my presentation. And hopefully I provided a lot of good thoughts for the panel that they can expand upon. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sergey. It was a great great presentation and certainly a very thought-provoking. So we're gonna transition next to the panel, and I'm gonna begin by introducing